How's everyone doing?
Awesome. Who thinks the worship team did an amazing job this morning? Woo! I just love that we have such a variety that get up here every week and just blow us away with worship and praise to God, right? I love it. All right, you get the unfortunate benefit of getting live announcements this morning. Instead of seeing me up on the sidewall, you'll see me up here, but I do warn you, live announcements also means live bloopers, so you may have to put up with that just a little bit. Okay, so we got a couple things coming up I want to tell you about. First of all, we have a class coming up called Financial Peace University. And Jessica and I actually had the privilege to take this the first year it was offered, and we were just blown away by what we learned and what we were able to do through that class. It says the average family pays off $5,300 in debt and saves $2,700 within the first 90 days. Now, this is a nine-week class, and it costs $93 for a couple or a single person, $93. But if you are a member here at Grace, then you will have that completely refunded to you if you have perfect attendance all 9 weeks. So it's a completely free class. You get all of Dave Ramsey's materials. You get his book, and you get the envelopes and everything you need to do, the system that he recommends. It's an amazing class. I think last year, Adam said that with everyone combined, they had saved and paid off a total of like $100,000 with everyone in the class. It made a huge difference, and the people that are still got it going, it's still making a huge difference in their finances. So if that's an area you need help or assistance in, this is the class for you. You will learn so much, I swear. You'll be blown away by it. Okay, so next week on February 5th is going to be our second annual Super Bowl Sunday. Now, if you remember our Super Bowl Sunday from last year, it was pretty awesome, right? Okay, so we're going to have our youth worship band leading worship, and it's going to be completely led by students this year. Like, our lead singers are going to be students, and Casey actually said he's not even going to have a mic, so he's not going to back them up at all. It is all on them. It's going to be amazing. They've been practicing and working really hard preparing for this, and they're doing an amazing job. Then we're going to have Sam and me facing off in head-to-head preaching. We're going to go back and forth. If you remember last year, we had some crazy phrases we had to include and some other rules they threw up on us right before we went on stage. It was a whole lot of fun. I want you guys to watch this video real quick just about last year.
Way the sport will take place, each one of them will preach a quarter, an 8-minute quarter. Do a coin toss, we hold that. You ready for the coin toss?
Christ had every right to come to earth and say, I'm the King of Kings, I'm the ultimate ruler, you know, build me a palace, feed me grapes.
All fall to temptation. We will all fall to sin. We will all be broken. We will all go through some times. We will all have discouragement. I take the snap, I come up. And we're planning to go bigger and better than we did last year. So if you're on Facebook and you have your phone with you right now, I want you to pull it out. And I want you to go to our Facebook page and share that video that you just watched. We want to get as many people as we can here because it's going to be awesome. We're planning to go bigger and better. Our halftime show is going to be more and still going to be led by our students. It's awesome. We're really excited. Okay, so that is next Sunday morning. Now, next Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock, we'll actually be having a live showing of the Super Bowl. So we're going to have the big game up here on our big screen, and we're going to have a lot of food. There's going to be fun. We're just going to hang out, watch the game. We're going to give each other a hard time because that's what we do during football. But another cool thing, we're going to be having a chili cook-off. So if you've got some awesome chili, we have 10 spots, right? Or we have 9 spots because Pastor Dennis has already filled one of those spots. And he says no one's going to be able to beat him. So you got to come, you got to make your best chili and try to dethrone Pastor Dennis because he says no one's going to beat him. I don't believe that. I believe someone out here is going to beat him. All right, make your best crock pot full of chili. You can sign up on the event page or just find one of us and let us know. All right, guys, so welcome Pastor Dennis.
Good morning. Hope you all come next week. Let's have a good time. There will be preaching. It gets wild on Super Bowl Sunday. We're in this series called Life Healing Choices. I think it's an awesome, awesome program. It's more than a program. It's a lifestyle. And it's when you think of the things in life that need to be healed, it's more than just a decision. It's more than a New Year's resolution. It takes more than that. But today we're talking about the commitment choice. And I'm going to back up here to choice one. The choice one I talked about is the reality choice. The reality choice is basically when you realize, you say, I'm not God. I admit I'm powerless to control my tendencies to do wrong things, and my life is unmanageable. You know, that's one thing. You come to that reality that, hey, my life is going to stay messed up if I just count on me. If I rely on me, it's never going to get much better. And you realize that you're not God, and so why try to quit trying to control the universe, control everybody around you, when you can't even control yourself? So it's coming to a reality. Then choice two is a hope choice. You're hoping. You're hoping for something. You know, I've heard one time someone out fishing in a pond, and the thing is, if you went fishing in a pond every single day and you never caught one, eventually, maybe they've stocked the lake. You know there's fish there. You can testify. You see other people catching the fish, but over a period of time, you do not catch any. Eventually, you lose hope. The fact that the fish are still there is a reality. Yeah, I mean, there's a fact, but you lose hope because it's not working for you. The hope choice is you earnestly believe that God exists. And that's a step for some to even get to the point that you believe God exists. But that's the hope choice. I hope there's a God because, the way I'm doing it sucks. I'm not good at changing any area of my life for a very long period of time. So I believe there is a God, that God exists. I'm hoping there is, and that I matter to him. I hope that, and I believe that that I matter to him and that he has the power to help me change. You may say, well, this is kind of a desperate thing. You're hoping, you're maybe praying, you're wishing, because you kind of realize if I can't do it and there's not a God in heaven that can help me, I'm pretty well doomed. So you're hoping. The only thing about what choice one and choice two has to do with, they remind me of a mirror. One time in youth camp, we were the director of youth camp, me and my wife, and we decided to do this thing that morning that you could get up and everybody was looking around the room at their cabins, and anybody could go to the mirror. They can go to the mirror, they can look in the mirror, but they cannot comb their hair at all. So the way you woke up, that's the way you had to attend breakfast that morning in the cafeteria. And my wife could tell you, she's here in first service, she can tell you that I've got the wackiest, craziest looking hair when I wake up that you ever seen. It is just bizarre. And but everybody in the entire camp had to go. I mean, men and women, girls and boys, we all had to go to camp with our hair just the way we woke up. And it was made for a lot of laughs, and it was a lot of fun. Later on that day, we were going to use that as a object lesson to the fact, James says, you don't just look into the mirror and walk away because nothing really happened. You know, they had these reflecting pools and they could look down and they could see themselves. And it was he compared the Word of God. The Word of God is like the mirror. You look into it, but if all you do is look into it, it does you no good. So really, when you think of church, choice one and choice two, they're basically observation choices, right? A lot of people, they are observation Christians. They think by going to church that they're a Christian. Well, going in a garage don't make you a car. Going into a chicken house doesn't make you a chicken. You know, there's got to be more than observation. You can observe that your life is unmanageable. Maybe even other people helped you observe that your life was unmanageable. They told you your life was unmanageable. And then, you know, you say, well, I hope, you know, I believe there is a God, and I believe he exists, and he has the power to change me. They're all just observation, basically. It's something, it's out there. I believe it can, maybe it will. But when we get to the third choice, the third choice is more than observation. It's commitment choice. I believe this is where everything hits the road. This is where the Bible either begins to have an effect on your life or not. This is where church has an effect on your life or not. This is where any kind of a program like this is where it all takes place. This is where it happens, the commitment choice. It's consciously choosing to commit all my life and will to Christ's care and control. You know, a mirror does you no good if you just look in it and go, I look bad today, or I look good today, and you walk away. You have to take what you're seeing and do something with it. So that's what we're hoping that will happen today. I want to give you, in every program, some people go, well, you know, I don't know if I can make a decision. A lot of people have a hard time making a decision. But here's the thing, that for people that have hard times making decision, here's the thing you've got to realize. When you don't make a decision, you made a decision. You made a decision not to do anything. It's not work. Well, Robbie's going to be leading this financial piece that Jeff was telling about coming up. We know of people after people. There's books written on people that the whole book is just testimonies of people that have totally got out of debt by following several steps that Dave Ramsey talks about. But I'm going to tell you can read the book and it will do you no good. You can even memorize the book and it would do you no good. You have to actually practice the book. We know people that's come and they did good for 3 or 4 months and then they quit doing those steps. And you go, well, it quit working for me. No, it didn't quit working for you. You quit working the steps. They would still be working if you would still be working them. Amazes me how people nowadays want people to give them something. The prodigal son, his problem was he come to his dad and he said, Dad, I want you to give me. I want you to give me. When he went away into his, dad gave him his inheritance. He went away to a far land. He blew everything he had. He come back to his father. And he didn't ask his father to give him anything. He said, I don't even deserve to be one of your servants. I just want to find a place on your farm that you'll let me serve. And he said, Father, make me. See, that's the attitude that we have to get in for things to actually start changing in our life. We got to quit wanting, something to be given to us. What if I said, you know, the Super Bowl's coming up, and I think, you know, I'm a big fan, and I think I deserve to go to the Super Bowl, and when I go up to the gate, if they don't let me in, I'm going to protest it because I deserve to go. Well, do you have a ticket? No, I don't have a ticket. But I think I need to go. See, there's always certain obligations. There's certain things, there's certain steps that have to be accounted for before things happen in your life. And it's a part of life. It's good to hear no sometimes. It is. It's good to hear wait sometimes. And God knows that about it. But I want to show you some steps to bondage. One of the things is, you cannot live in this life without having some hurts. We all have hurts. Things happen in our childhood that leaves a scar. And it hurts. Something happens in a marriage and it leaves a hurt. Something happens on a job and it leaves a hurt. Something happens in a family and it leaves a hurt. We all have hurts. A lot of times what we do when we get a hurt, we go, I'm never going to let that person ever hurt me again. We kind of get what they, you know, today we hear a lot about post-traumatic stress syndrome. The idea, and I didn't fully understand this, how that somebody could just almost involuntarily react to something that they've been through. But a few years ago, I was coming down to actually get someone ready for a wedding. We was going to go through the rehearsal. And I was right up here about where the high school is. And I was stopped at a red light. And this person come over this hill. And they just hit me in the rear of my car very, very fast. And when it hit the rear, I hit the car in front of me. So it smashed my car from front and back. And I mean, it really jarred me quite a bit. I come up here and I kind of went through the ceremony a little bit. And I should have not have been here, but I went home and I was like, I'm all tensed up. The next morning, I was at the emergency room trying to get help. My back was in horrible shape. Took me a long time to get over it. But here's the thing. From that hurt, something psychologically began to go on in my mind. And I got where I found myself at a red light, and I would be holding onto the steering wheel as hard as I could, and I'd be watching the mirror. See, I had no reason to believe the person behind me was a bad driver. I had no reason to believe that the person behind me would not stop. But I had a tendency to want to turn my steering wheel and move away from, you know, try to go off around the side of the road if I seen anybody coming up behind me, because I had this bad, bad experience that was locked in my mind. I couldn't get away from it. Some of you have got some bad experiences in marriage. Some of you got some bad memories of childhood. Some of you have got some bad hurts, and you need them healed. I used to love to ride. I had a Harley, and I used to love to ride that Harley. I mean, it was like the joy. As I told people, that was my escape. If it wasn't nothing but get on it and ride it over to Fall Creek Falls or somewhere, it's like just going down the road, and just like you could forget about everything, and it was just that peace of mind. After that accident, though, that didn't seem like a peace of mind. Every time I sat at a red light, it's like, man, I don't know, if somebody come up and hit me from behind on a motorcycle now, it would really hurt. And so it took that pleasure out of something I enjoyed doing. And a lot of people have similar things like that, whether they've been away in war, they've had something in a marriage, they had something in a childhood. Now that hurt is feeding over into other relationships today. All right. What happens, though, we normally try to develop a way of life, a routine of life, or a habit in life to kind of cover up or disguise that hurt. Like whether it's me, it's things I start avoiding. I start avoiding trying to watch out at lights, avoiding driving a motorcycle, riding my motorcycle. But some people develop habits. Some people, they develop escapes on the computer. They develop escapes on video games. And they say, well, I just love video games because my mind don't think of anything. Some of it's gambling. Some of it's alcohol. Some of it's drugs. Some of it's religion. It's all kind of escapes. Some of it's vacations. You just got to get away. But what happens, that routine, you get where you feel like you got to have that every week just like that because it's covering up a hurt. Your life has got to run the same way all the time because you're actually covering up a hurt. Sometimes the habits, they can go from mild to very difficult. The habits could be destroying everything. You can't keep a job because of your habit. You can't keep a marriage because of your habit. Your family can't stand you because of your habit. The habit can be very detrimental to a lot of people. A habit doesn't necessarily have to be a sin, as we think of sins in terminology. But it's a cover-up. Well, when our habit starts getting out of control and it's affecting people around us, or it's hindering relationships or hurting marriages, or what people do, they want to come in and they want to rescue you or help you with your habit. That's where most programs start at, is the rescuing you from your habit. Actually, what you have a greater need of is not rescuing from your habit. You need a rescuing from your hurt. See, healing the habit while ignoring the hurt doesn't work. It's like that air mattress I talked about, and you've got these habits and stuff on you. You go, I'm going to stomp this out. And if the air inside that mattress represents the hurt, it just shifts it. but nothing has really been accomplished. That's where we find ourselves. We find ourselves in this miserable place that without a God that can change our heart, without a God that can change our mind, renew our minds, without a God that can give us a willpower beyond our willpower, we are doomed. We're hopeless. And so we need, and that's why this program is called Life's Healing Choices. So we go a little further and we find that there are steps, just like there's steps to coming out of something, there's steps of going down into something. And like guilt, guilt and anger and fear and depression. One writer said, one psychologist said, Carl Menninger, he said 83% of people in mental hospitals today could go home if they knew they were forgiven. They're holding on to such guilt, and this guilt is turned inward. And guilt that's turned inward will begin to destroy you. You begin to have anger. You're angry because you can't carry on normal relationships. You're angry because you feel the way you feel, and you hate and you despise, and you've got all these emotions going on, and you fear that you will never get any better, and you start being depressed. People say that depression is anger turned inward. Anger turned inward. And you're just so angry and you can't hardly make it through life. Only God can help you with things like that. Now, you can try on your own, and you'll get a little ways, but I want to show you why it's so important to get real, genuine healing from God. See, why do we try to conquer the habit? You know, we try to conquer the habit, but then we replace it. We just kind of replace it. We trade up or trade down to a different habit because we haven't dealt with the hurt. We want people not to just trade habits or trade up to even a better habit that your family can deal with. We want you to deal with the hurt. We just replace it with a different habit. It's sick. It's a vicious cycle. And it leaves us with a doorstep of pain and misery. We keep going down, down, down. See, the Bible tells us that bitterness. See, a lot of people, they have something happen to them and they begin to have unforgiveness. And the unforgiveness, and the Bible said forgive. Forgive as your Heavenly Father forgives. You know, if you forgive, He'll forgive you. We don't think of how important that is. But see, God, He made us. He made our physical being, our mind, our spirit. He knows everything about us. And He knows that unforgiveness is very detrimental to us. So He says, if you have an ought against your brother, you know, and you're trying to come and pray to God, you just need to get up and go make that right with your whoever you got that ought with, that fault with, that sin, that unforgiveness, you need to go get that taken care of. And He says that unforgiveness needs to be dealt with as quickly as possible. Preferably, don't even let the sun go down before you deal with that unforgiveness. You ever had something that bothers you, and the longer you go, the angrier you get, the madder you get, and actually you start getting bitter. I'm just so mad that that person's had a space in my head for so long. It just makes me sick, and I'm even madder at them now because they've ruined the whole day, a whole week, a whole month, or a part of my lifetime, and that unforgiveness turns to the bitterness. And the Bible talks about you need to root out the bitterness right away. Don't let bitterness stay. Dig up the bitterness. Get it out of your heart. You need to get rid of it as fast as you can because it will, you know, it'll like metastasize. It will take hold of your mind and your body, and it'll become more and more difficult to get rid of the bitterness. Well, bitterness not dealt with turns into malice. And malice is the root word for malignancy. And just like that psychologist, Carl Menninger, said 83% of people could go home from mental hospital if they knew they were forgiven, if the condemnation, the guilt was gone. So that way, some people are bound mentally. There's some people, they have physical ailments that can only be healed by going down the steps of getting rid of unforgiveness and bitterness and malice the way the Bible talks about. So when God asks us to do things in the Word of God, there's a reason for everything. And the reason you would not follow God's instructions on this is you still think you're God and God don't know what He's talking about. That's just the honest truth. The good news is we can heal our hurts and we can experience greater joy and deeper peace and more enriching relationships and a more profound wisdom. We can live out God's given potential for us. We can. It's a possibility to live a different life. Here's the thing. We go back to this. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. How many has ever heard of Monty Python? It's crazy old films, but there's one, The Life of Brian. They're talking like Jesus is talking, and they're going, what'd he say? And they're passing the word back, passing the word back, passing the word back. And he says, blessed are the meek. Blessed are the peacemakers. And but he tells them, they pass it on back, and they go, I think he said, blessed are the cheesemakers. Some of you have got a secondhand religion, a secondhand gospel, and you really don't know what God has said about your life. You've tried, trying to be a cheesemaker, and you need to be a peacemaker. And you don't have all the facts. Some way or another, you've got to say, well, I don't know if I understand this word, but I'm going to try it again. But he said, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. We think that meek means weak. It doesn't mean weak. It means strength under control. It's like you were to take a wild horse out here and you were to train them and you were to break them and you would take them through this process and then they become very productive. They're very strong. They're very powerful. But now they're strength under control. They're strength under control. They become useful. They become purposeful. And a lot of times our life is unruly. It's not under control. Christ who suffered for you is your example. Follow his steps. See, we think that Christianity is a one-step method. It's one step, but it's not. Follow Jesus' steps. It's plural, right? Steps. He never sinned and he never deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted. When he suffered, he did not threaten to get even. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judged fairly. See, our insecurities cause us to want to retaliate. You know, if somebody tells something to you, you know, if somebody says, look at Dennis, he's got red hair. Well, you know, if I know I don't have red hair, then I just know that there's no truth to what they're saying, so therefore, I don't care that you said that. It seems to be the older you get, the less you care about what other people think anyway. When you're younger, you'll buy stuff that you don't need to impress people you don't like with money that you don't have. And then you need to be in financial peace. Eventually, you get to the place, well, I don't care whether you like it or not, I like it. And Jesus knew who he was. They could say, well, you're not the Son of God. It didn't matter. Jesus knew he was the Son of God. He didn't need to argue about it. If you're inferior, you ever see anybody that they get on, they talk to you in conversation, on Facebook, in person, wherever you come in contact, they're always bragging. That's a sure sign that person is insecure. They're very insecure. They're talking way above, you know, what they can do. It's a sign of their insecurity. Jesus didn't have to say anything. Now, if I was Jesus, I would be a lot different. You know, after I got resurrected after 3 days, I would come back and I would wipe up the town with the people that crucified me. Take that, buddy. You thought I wasn't God now. How do you like me now? I just thump them all off, you know. But see, that's why I'm not allowed to be God. But Jesus wasn't that way. Jesus knew he was God. You can crucify me and spit on me and beat me, and you can do all that stuff, and it has yet to prove anything, but I'm still God. See, Paul was one of those, when his name was Saul, I've been to the best schools, I've been taught by the greatest teachers, I'm the best scholar there is, nobody knows religion like me. That's the way Saul was. He's a bragger. He's a little short guy, too. He had the little man complex. That's what he was. Paul was a little short guy. And Paul said, like, I think it's better for a man not even touch a woman. Probably he didn't have a choice anyway. He's act like he was a little short, long-nosed little guy. That's like a lot of people, they go, I wouldn't even touch a woman. You probably wouldn't, because a woman probably wouldn't let you touch her anyway. But it's that complex that you're going to go ahead and say what you would never do. Well, I would never buy one of those cars. No, you would never buy one of those cars because you can't afford it. But see, it's that complex of trying to sound superior in areas that you're really not superior. But Saul was like that. He was like bragging and bragging. And one day, this guy Stephen stood up for what he believed. And Saul goes, what are you talking about? You standing up against what I'm saying? I'm the guy, man. You don't know nothing. And so he had Stephen put to death. He stoned him. But even when he stoned Stephen just, he was happy, he was glorious, and go, hey, you can stone me, but I'm going to heaven right now, bud. And it said that God was so pleased with Stephen that Jesus stood up at the right hand of the Father and welcomed Stephen home. That day, something happened in Saul's life. Something began to eat on him. Well, what has he got that I don't have? He embarrassed me in front of all my men. And he was on his high horse and God knocked him off. And he blinded him. And there began to be steps and changes in Saul's life. And he became Paul, and he became a meek man. He became a great man. He began to be this man, a little man, but he became a little man that was powerful in the kingdom of God. See, meekness has always been God's way of humanity. When we're strong, we have a tendency not to want to rely on God. But when we're weak, we have no choice but to rely on God. See, now the man Moses was very meek. Now, he wasn't originally very meek, but he became meek. He had a side of him. His mom was very humble, and she got to be his caretaker even in Pharaoh's house. So he had a mom's side, and he had a Pharaoh side. A lot of times he acted a lot like Pharaoh. But when he said, well, I tell you what, I'm going to go lead my people out of bondage. And he went and he started a riot, and he killed a man, and then he went to the far side of the desert. That's what you do when you try to do it yourself. Most of the time, when you do it yourself, you're going to fail. But Moses, finally, God said, now, Moses, now we're going to do what you wanted to do, but we're going to do it my way. And Moses went and he led millions of people out of bondage. God's way. God's way. And God set him and these people free very easily, God's way. And see, Moses was very weak, meek, more than all men that were on the face of the earth. He became a meek man, and he 100% relied on God, and he became a great deliverer of the people. Meekness means acknowledging God's holiness. God, you're holy. God, you're the only one. Listen how it's done in Scripture. See, meekness is a confidence in who I am. But it's also a confidence in who you're not. You know, I am. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. That's what Paul said. I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that I've committed to him. So you see, he is confident. He began to have confidence, but his confidence was God-related. Meekness is the confidence in who I am. And here's what he says. God, you're God. See, that's a great place to get. God, you're God. I'm not. God, you're the God of all gods. You're the master of all masters. A God immense in power and awesome. See, God, that's the God I serve. And see, so Moses began to see that if he had a God that great, why should he ever rely on himself? That would be foolish. He needed to rely on God. Meekness is a confidence not only in who you are not, or I am what I am through the grace of God. That's kind of the Popeye religion. I am what I am that I am, you know. And so meekness is whose I am. How many, we got some women in here that don't normally like to fight, but how many women in here will go to bat over your children? You'll fight. Don't mess with a woman that's protecting your children. Don't mess with a father. Domestic issues are some of the most dangerous issues because people will fight for their family. And so when you think of this, whose I am? Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is the child of God. You're a child of God. And when you become a child of God, God will fight for you. He will defend you. He will protect you. He will help you because why? You're his child. You're his child. You need to tell the devil, you need to get off my back, devil, because I'm a child of God. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Get lost, devil. So see, you realize you're a child of God. So you consciously make a decision. I've got Bill Fletcher's going to come up and give his testimony. And hey, Bill, I got you an actual stand this time. I mean, we've moved up a big time since first service. And we got a mic that works. See there? All right, give Bill a big hand today as he gives his testimony.
Thanks, Dennis. For years, I struggled with abandonment issues, self-worth, and codependency. I didn't even know what codependency was until I got into CR and found out just how screwed up I was. I tried to deal with all of those by abusing alcohol, drugs, and sex. Today, I'm a grateful believer in the forgiveness and the healing power of Jesus Christ and the CR program. This is part of my story. I was put up for an adoption at birth and spent the first several months of my life in an orphanage. Eventually, I was adopted by an older Christian couple that were unable to have children. Father was in his mid-40s and mother was just a couple years behind. When I was 4, I was taken back to the orphanage and asked to pick out the baby girl that would become my sister Mary. Because of the way we were raised, she and I grew up as best friends. My father had a doctor's degree in electrical engineering and was a college professor at one of the top universities in the country. Mom was a well-educated homemaker. My folks had two life goals. One was to serve Christ to the best of their ability and be the most dedicated Christians they could be. And two, to raise their children to do the same and by keeping Mary and I from the sinful influences of the world. Our home was a tender place. My testimony tends to be a bit different than many in that the abuse that I endured as a child was not caused by an alcoholic father or a drug-filled home. It was not done in fits of anger or neglect, and it certainly was not sexual in any way. In fact, I'm reluctant to even use the term abuse. Today, I recognize that it was more a case of inappropriate discipline. It will become more clear as I go on. I started school when I was 4 because I would turn 5 during that school year. I think now that that was a mistake. I was so lost and overwhelmed. I was shy, small, and scared, and very, very lost. From the start, I was behind the other kids my age, and I never caught up. I remember feeling like an abandoned little kid in a strange and dangerous place, wondering how I got there. I don't want to spend too much time talking about childhood and school time in my life, but there are a few incidences that I need to share for my testimony to make sense. As I said, I was shy, small, and scared, and very lost. My father had some strange beliefs and sayings that guided his life and the way that he raised us. One was spare the rod and spoil the child. While the Bible does teach that discipline is good for the child, my parents carried it further than needed. Here is one incident that left scars and wounds. This is one of several that happened, but this is the one I'll share. When I was in 4th grade, we were working on the multiplication tables in school, and I was struggling to make sense out of it. One evening, I was told to bring my homework into my folks' bedroom, and Mom was sitting up in bed doing a crossword puzzle. I placed my work on Dad's side of the bed, and Father stood behind me to look over my shoulder and ask the math questions. 6 times 8. And I struggled to figure it out, and I would take my best guess and get it wrong. Time after time, I got the problems wrong, and Father decided that I was not applying myself and not paying attention, so he got the power cord from his electric razor and whipped my PJ'd bottom. Every wrong answer got a lashing. Many wrong answers and many welts later, I was crying, Mom was crying, Father was crying, the cat was crying, everybody was crying. I was sent to bed. As I headed down the hall to my room, I heard Dad ask Mom, "Do you think God wanted us to adopt a dumb son?" I got a lot of whippings with the razor power cord for various infractions, or perhaps just not for applying myself. Often when I was confused and not understanding something, Father would look at me and ask with great concern and great disappointment, "Are you dumb, son? Are you a dumb bunny?" That was kind of his nickname for me. The facts be known and the truth be told, I did have learning problems, and I was a disappointment to my folks. School was rough. I should have been in the slow kids class or at least helped by a tutor, but the school system was way overcrowded and I was small, shy, and so lost that I became the quiet, almost invisible kid in a corner. I was uncoordinated, and so I was an easy target for the bullies and got picked on a lot. Another one of Father's sayings that I heard often went something like this: "One boy might be good, two boys won't be good, three boys can't be good." In other words, anytime there were more than two boys, they would be unable to stay out of trouble. As a result of this belief and the goal of raising their children to be uncontaminated by worldly influences, I was not allowed to play much with other neighborhood kids. I didn't go to their houses for birthday parties or sleepovers, and kids were not invited to our house. My folks felt that most of the parents in the neighborhood were unchristian, so their houses and yards and kids were off limits to me. Camping trips, for example, with Boy Scouts were out because that meant missing church on Sunday. For me, church became an obligation instead of an opportunity to worship, a requirement rather than a relationship. I guess I viewed God as being like my earthly father, judgmental with strict rules, the only purpose of which was to limit fun. 1 Thessalonians 5:22 says, "Abstain from all appearance of evil." In our church, that meant don't associate with non-Christians in a friendly way. Preach to them and help them if you can, but keep your distance. I so much wanted friends and to be able to fit in. After high school, I attended a small Bible college, married a church girl, and made plans to go into the ministry. I had an affair, and all of those plans were sidetracked. Father told me how disappointed he was, and he said that he had always tried to treat me like a real son. Instead of being a minister, I headed to the army. The guys in the army were great. They were just the opposite of the Christians I had grown up with. These guys were not wimps. They did not live their life in fear. What a change. What a change. I soon found out that I could be as tough and as fearless as the next guy and spent the next 4 years in a hardcore unit jumping out of planes to prove it. Of course, there was all the drinking, drugs, and women that are often a part of the military life, and I partook of it all with gusto. My sister Mary was killed in a one-car accident while I was in the service, and I was devastated. I was so mad at God. She was a wonderful, young Christian lady. I wore my dress uniform to the funeral, complete with my new sergeant stripes. At the church dinner after the services, there was a lull in the conversation. In the quiet, in the moment, in the fellowship hall, everyone heard someone comment to Father, "You must be very proud of Bill. It looks like he's doing good in the service." Still, in the quiet of the hall, we heard him say, "No, I always hoped he'd be an officer." I left as soon as I could to go back to my unit. And that was pretty much the end of my relationship with my folks. I was so resentful and angry at the unjust punishment and unfair rules. I was angry with God. I was angry with the church for being judgmental and condemning. I knew that I was a disappointment to my parents, and I also knew that there was nothing I could do to change that. After the service, I moved back to Colorado, and for the next several years, I continued to live a worldly lifestyle. I drank a lot, and I did whatever drugs I could get and had several relationships. I'm amazed that I survived those years, and it's only by the grace of God that I'm here today. I had no purpose, and I was looking for something to give my life meaning. After a very dark time, when life did not seem worth the trouble and I seriously thought about ending it, I was introduced to a secular 12-step program that helped me begin to understand what was wrong with my life. I was not paying attention to God and to spiritual things. As I took a close look at the steps, they began to make sense. My life was a mess and out of control. I began to understand and accept the fact that the only way to get a life that I liked better was to try a different way of living. However, I didn't know how to do that. The only thing I hadn't really tried was to live a life praying for and accepting God's direction. I had accepted Christ when I was young because I was expected to. But I needed to consciously choose to be a Christian as an adult and because I believed the scriptures, not because it was expected and based on someone else's belief. I began to ask God for guidance. It wasn't instantaneous, but slowly my life began to improve. There were many relapses and mistakes, but gradually I began to see a path. I rededicated my life, and over the next few years, God led me to a wonderful lady that became my wife, a lady that has supported and stood beside me and believed in me. Then God led us to a small church in South Georgia and a ministry called Celebrate Recovery. Finally, after years of detours and dirt roads, I was home with the kind of friends that could help me grow. Amazingly, I was asked to serve as one of the pastors of the church. Wow, what a great God we serve, a God of second and third and fourth chances, a healing God that gives us new life. God was using me to help others get over the things that kept them from drawing close to God. I had spent years being resentful of the rules and the restrictions that my folks had placed on me. I was angry at the unjust punishments, and I was very disappointed and self-condemning for not being as smart and as successful as my parents wanted. I realized that I would never be his real son, and there was nothing I could do to change that. As I worked the steps in Celebrate Recovery, I began to understand the hurts that I had and the hang-ups that those hurts had caused, and then the habits that I had used to temporarily relieve the pain and disappointment. I began to understand that I had been carrying my hurts and disappointments kind of like war wounds. In a strange way, I was playing a game called Ain't It Awful. I think some of us like to kind of like being a victim. It gives us a good reason to find a way to escape, like drugs or alcohol or shopping. I had to answer the question, do I want to get rid of my hurts, hang-ups, and harmful habits? I had spent years judging my parents. I understand now that my parents carried out their own hurts and their own baggage and were trying as best they could. I had spent years condemning them for not understanding and for not being better Christians while I was a huge sinner and living a very ungodly life. I spent years condemning and unforgiving myself. I had not forgiven them, and I had not forgiven myself. Ephesians 4, 31 and 32 says, "Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." When we say the Lord's Prayer, we say these words, "Forgive us our trespasses in the same way that we forgive others. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven." Luke 6, 37. Because of CR, I realize that it is what I have experienced that makes me who I am today. I'm able to help many, many more people because of my past. I understand struggles. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." Fact is, bad things happen to good people. Bad things happen to bad people. But it's only by allowing God to work in our lives that God can bring good out of the bad. Amen? Perhaps there are hurts and resentments that you need to deal with. This may be the time CR can help. Celebrate Recovery is people with scars helping people with wounds. Thanks for letting me share.
Thank you, Bill. That's all right, Will. Good job, Bill. Appreciate that. What a powerful testimony. It really is. Here's the thing that I've found about anything in life, whether it's religion, Christianity, any self-help type program, it's consciously you make a decision. In other words, you choose to commit. But here's the problem that has pretty much ruined a lot of religion, a lot of programs, is people think it's a one-time commitment, a one-time decision. I hear that often. People go, well, I gave my heart to the Lord 30 years ago. Yeah, but you haven't done anything since then. Nothing. That was a great day in your life, but that was not the end. See, you choose to commit. You choose to commit over and over and over and over and over again. It's not one time. Let me back up here. Don't you realize that whatever you choose to obey becomes your master? And you can choose sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God and receive His approval, His approval and favor. You just don't know how important the favor or the approval of God is in all of our lives. But if you'll notice in this verse of Scripture, there's three times He uses the word choose, choose, choose. You can choose. It's your choice. You can choose. God's not going to force you. Here's the thing. If you go on a date with somebody and you go on this date and you choose to have sex and your partner chooses not to, what do they call that? Some of you have been raped by churches. They forced you in a decision one time in a service that really wasn't your decision. Somebody wanted you to make that decision. Somebody begged you to make that decision. Folks around you. And in a sense, you were forced against your actual will to make a decision. Sometimes that happens in recovery. Somebody forces you to go. You're mandated to go, and you're forced to go. And the reason that doesn't go anywhere because it's not your decision. This talks about you choose. You get to choose. You can choose one way or another. God will always give you a choice. You can choose. You can choose to obey God. You can choose to follow sin. If you do, you're the consequences. There's consequences to whichever way you choose. To choose the way to sin leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which receives His approval, His favor. There's something great about having the favor of God. Amen. Favor of God. It's God's power. It's His favor. Here's the thing. What is driving you? The Bible teaches us that there's a body, there's a soul, and there's a spirit. The Apostle Paul found out in Romans 7, you've heard me say this a lot of times, you've been around here, Romans 7, 32 times the personal pronoun I. Paul was trying, or Saul at that time, was trying to live driven by the body. If you even refer to his writings, you'll find out he uses body, soul, and spirit in that order. In Romans 7, he goes, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? I cannot go on like I'm going on anymore." He had a reality moment. Then he said, he goes, "Only Jesus Christ, only Jesus can change me. Only, oh wretched man, only Jesus can change me." From that point on, if you follow Paul's writing, when his name was changed to Paul, he uses spirit first, and then soul, and then body. Here's the thing. If your body and your cravings of your body and your wants of your body and your habits of body is driving you, this right here, you go, "Well, should I eat it or should I not? Should I smoke it or should I not? Should I snort it or should I not? Should I drink it or should I not?" These two right here is going to overrule this every time. And if you don't know Jesus Christ, you don't have this anyway. The light's gone out. You have no spirit to help you. Read Romans 7, then read Romans 8. In Romans 8, he said, there is now no more condemnation. I'm not condemned anymore. I'm not doing wrong anymore. There's now no more condemnation of those that walk not after the flesh, but are walk after the Spirit. Here's what happens in Paul's life. Paul changes, and now he's led by the Spirit. And so his Spirit gives him power. Greater is he that is in you. The Spirit has been reunited with God. And God then helps you renew your mind. So you go, now, should I do it or should I don't? You know, should I do it or... And normally you'll give in to the body, but when the Spirit joins you, you're outnumbered. You know, I think I can, I think I can't. You're both is right. If you don't think you can, you're not. If you think you can, you can. And if you do it through the Holy Spirit, you go, well, I wish I had a sponsor. One of the sponsors you have when you come to know Jesus Christ, you've got the sponsor of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will lead and guide you in all truth. You start to do wrong, the Holy Spirit goes, don't do that. You shouldn't do that. I'm going to give you the power to not do that. You don't need to do that. So we have the Spirit. You'll find those that are led by the Spirit will not fulfill the lust of the flesh or the works of the flesh. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit are God's sons, are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery. God doesn't want you to be in slavery. He doesn't want you bound by these things. It, in slavery, that returns you to the fear and the guilt and that whole downward spiral. But you received the spirit of sonship by whom we cry, He's our Father. See, it's not a bad thing to serve God. But if you ever serve God, it's got to be your choice. It can't be forced. It can't be beat down on you as religious. That's why I go, people, why do you do your church like you do it? Because Christianity, a decision for Jesus Christ, is your decision. All right, let me tell you how this decision works, because it's highly important. All my life and will, everything. What do you have to give to God to follow Him? Everything. What does God want? Everything. Turn to your neighbor and say, God wants everything. See, so no one can become my disciple without giving up everything for me. We've had a lot of people that half-heartedly thought they could serve God. And now they realize it has no real effect to half-heartedly serve God. See, this word right here, he says, don't forget the assembling of yourself together. That's why we need to go to church. You need to go when you feel like it. You need to go when you don't feel like it. You go, my kids didn't want to go today. I bet if your kids don't want to go to school tomorrow, you're going to make them go to school tomorrow, right? See, you teach. There's a lot of things in this Bible that I don't even understand. I may not even agree with, but He says do it, and He's my everything, and I'm going to do everything He says to the best of my abilities. Because why? It didn't say do half. You do half is you don't get the favor of God. When you do all, you get the favor of God. You know, he says where your treasures are, that's where your heart is. You're talking about giving, your tithes. He says give 10%. Well, what if I only give 5%? What if I only give 2? What if you want to... See, there's a lot of things in here. The world is challenging this word right now. But here's the thing. If we want everything, we need to give everything. He said you're going to give it all up. Christ, care, and control. He loves me. I want you to say this out loud with me. If Jesus is not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. I want you to think about that. If Jesus is not Lord of all in your life, if he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. You can't take a half-hearted response to God and get the favor of God. That's the difference between real change and make-believe change. If you want real change, you've got to really give your heart to God. You've got to really say, God, you are everything to me. I want everything that you are. I want to give you all of me. And the reason you do that, because you know Christ cares for you and he has the ability to control you because he loves you. Come to me, all you who are weary and overburdened, and I'll give you rest. That's his promise. See, there's a lot of promises in the Word of God, but those promises have conditions. We want the promise, but we very seldom don't want the condition. I'm just telling you, you know, I say, well, I want to go to the Super Bowl. And I deserve to go to the Super Bowl because I like the Super Bowl. And you go, well, I don't have a ticket. Well, you can't go without a ticket. There's so many things in life we're wanting just because we're wanting. Here's the commitment choice. Consciously choose to commit all, say all, my life and will to Christ's care and control. I, Jesus, came so they can have real and eternal life, more and better life than they ever dreamed of. Here's the steps. I accept God's Son as my Savior. Folks, there's only one Savior that died for you, and that's Jesus. Amen. I accept God's Son as my Savior. That's something you have to choose. I can't do it for you. I accept God's Word as my standard. In other words, if God's Word says it, I'm going to do it. And the reason I'm going to do it is because He said it. And He cares for my life. And He loves me. And if I want His unconditional love, and I want His favor, and I want His help, I need to follow His standard. I need to follow His standard. I accept God's will as my purpose. See, God's got a will for every one of our lives. And God's will is so powerful and so wonderful to be in the will of God and in the favor of God. If I accept God, if I accept His will, I accept God's power as my strength. If you want real strength, you got to give it all, everything to God. That's where real recovery takes place. And it's not a one time. Paul said, I die daily. So even as Christians, you're not off the hook. I'm not off the hook. Every morning I got to get up and say, hey, Dennis Daniels, you know who's in control? God's in control. Don't you ever forget that. There is a God and you're not Him. Paul said he got up every day and he died daily to God. He told himself, the Holy Spirit's going to direct my life. Jesus got up and went out in the morning and prayed. And he said, I'm going to follow the Spirit. And he followed the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God living in you, and He has power to give you strength to overcome whatever you need to overcome in your life. He has the power to help you forgive whatever you need to forgive in life. He's got the power to help you over that hurt, that bitterness, that anger. Only God. But folks, I can't do that for you. Only you can make that decision. How long are you going to keep going? Jesus stood on the side of the mountain in Jerusalem. He goes, how many times have I wanted to gather you? How many times have I wanted to help you, but you would not come? God will not force you. God will not force you to make the right decision. That's up to you. It's up to you. Can we bow our heads? Team, if you'll come out. I want to ask you something today. You just heard a very powerful testimony of someone. Religion didn't make a whole lot of difference in his life, but Christ did. Some of you have got religion, but you never got Christ. Some of you may have made a decision a long time ago, but you need to make some more decisions. And I want to ask you a question today. I want to ask you a question this morning about a choice. Are you willing to let Jesus be Lord of all in your life? If you will you raise your hand? I'm willing to make Jesus Lord of all. Because if He's not Lord of all, He's not Lord at all. I'm willing to give Him my everything. Raise your hand. I'm willing to give Him my everything. Because, all right, one more. If you're willing to let His Word be your standard, you're willing to, if it's in His Word and it says you need to do it, you're going to ask God's strength. You're willing to let God be your standard. Raise your hand. See, if He's not Lord of all, He's not Lord at all. And if you do that, you realize that He loves you and He cares for you. He's going to give you the power and the strength to make the changes in your life you need to make. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You today. Lord, it took me a long time in my ministry, Lord. For a long time, I had religion. I kind of had a forced choice decision that I thought that I made a choice a long time ago, and that just done it all. But God, I've realized over a period of time that I must walk this path with You. I must get up every day, and I must make a choice There's steps to following Christ, not just one step. There's decisions for Christ, not just one decision. There's choices in following Christ, not just one choice. God, I pray that you would make this congregation, Lord, there's some going through some difficult times right now. They need your help, and I need your help. We cannot make it without you. And God, I pray that you would empower this congregation to be that strong body that you envisioned and you told about as you walk this earth, the real body of Christ. God, I ask it today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. As they play this last song, I want us to stand at this time. If you'd like prayer today, I'd like to pray with you in closing, or if our prayer team wants to come up with me. We serve a great God, and the great news is we've got a healer. We've got a healer that can heal your hurts. We got a healer that can make a difference in your life. We've got a healer in God today that no matter how many times you've tried, you can accomplish it through Jesus Christ today. God bless you. If you want prayer, come today. Come up here with me. Somebody may want prayer. You won't be able to pray with you.
And he is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy.